We are moving forward to our first session of the day, which is going to be about a tour in the Museum of Microbes. And I am referring to the museum called Micropia, directly from Amsterdam in the Netherlands. And I've been there a couple of weeks ago, and it was a fun and unique experience. So I'm very much looking forward for all of you guys to see what Micropia has to offer. So I have Jasper with me, who is the manager of the Micropia Museum, right? And he's going to give us a few words before actually going and having the tour. So yeah, Jasper, over to you.
Thank you, Eleni. Hello, everyone. My name is Jasper. I'm the head of Micropia, the world's first and still only microbe museum. And I'm really thrilled that you've asked us to be part of the program. Of course, the International Microbe Day, in our mind, of course, is a very important day to, well, get something more about microbes and their huge presence in our lives, even though a lot of people don't realize that, out in the open a bit more. So that's why I'm really thankful that we got this opportunity. But having said that, I'm presenting now from our lab, which is also part of the museum, which Eleni will know, of course. But of course, today we will show you a bit more about Micropia itself. And that's being done by Remco Kort, a professor from the Free University here in Amsterdam, who's also part-time the Micropia professor, because Micropia is more than a museum. We also want to be a platform where we not only tell our visitors something more about microbes, but also make connections between, well, for instance, the university and our public, but also different commercial partners, nonprofits, other museums. And that's something that we're continuously working on. And that's why I'm also really thrilled to be here. Maybe we get to know some more of you guys here. If you're ever interested, just send us an email. We're always willing to hear you out. But like I said, I'd like to now give the floor to Remco Kort to give you a bit more information about the museum, how we got to build a Micropia. And then in between, I'll be back here in the lab to tell you something more. And at the end, of course, for the Q&A.
Yeah, great. Thank you, Jasper. Just to mention to all of you guys that are watching that we are monitoring our social media channels. So if you do have any questions about Micropia or any other things that you want to know about IMD, do comment them below and we're going to address them at the end of the session. So Ben, can we have the video from the tour, please?
Absolutely.
Great. Thank you.
Hello, welcome. My name is Remco Kort and I'm affiliated as a professor in microbiology with the Vrije Universiteit in Amsterdam and connected to Artis Micropia, the first and only microbe museum in the world. And what I will tell you about today is that this museum is actually more than only a museum, and let's dive into that. So I'm right here located in the museum at the center of Amsterdam, and the museum is actually part of Artis. It's the oldest zoo in Europe. And if you look here behind me, you see this map of Amsterdam, probably well known to many of you, with these typically horseshoe-shaped canals. And right here, you see where the Microbe Museum is located. So it's just next to the zoo. And in the development of the ID for Micropia, this was actually initiated by the former director called Haik Balian, and he was wondering what would be the role of artists, what would be the role of zoo nowadays? Is this just a mausoleum to keep endangered species, or should a zoo be much more than that? Well, actually, it's good to know that Artis was founded by the Zoological Society already in 1838 with a mission. And its mission was to reflect upon the position of mankind to nature. And considering this, it would be really great if we could, let's say, take this role again for a zoo. So it's much more than just a place where you keep animals, but it's also a place of getting in contact to nature in the middle of the city, and actually also a way to stimulate our what is called biophilia. So that's the innate tendency to connect to nature, and artists is really a beautiful place to do that. So it's actually not only a zoo, only the zoo in terms of animals, but there's also a botanical garden, and you will find there in a beautiful aquarium as well as a planetarium. And the former director was thinking, how can we extend that? Because he really liked innovation. So how to innovate a zoo? Well, you could think of, for example, a new animal. It's a bit complicated. But at one point, he considered that, in fact, this innovation is already there all around us. It's the majority of life forms which are invisible, but have never shown in a zoo. So this actually initiated the idea for Micropia now more than 15 years ago. And he figured out, well, how do we attract now young people to this zoo? And he was thinking of a kiss, because in the mouth, this is a very complex ecological system of microbes. And actually, during an intimate kiss, you transfer these microbes. So wouldn't be a kiss the way to also interest young people for the topic of microbes? So in fact, it all started with a kiss. So when I became involved in the development of Micropia as a museum, this was in 2006, and we were working in a small team with 8 people on the development of this museum. So we were there with an exhibition designer, with a science journalist, with a microscopist, and a content manager, and myself as a bacteriologist. And we were having meetings for a period of 8 years to talk about this development. And it was really complicated, because you can imagine this world of invisible microorganisms is enormous in terms of diversity, but also in terms of topics you can put in the museum. So we were brainstorming about how and where should we put the limits. And each time when we were considering a framework, there was another topic that was just falling outside of it, but definitely we wanted to show this as well. And this slide here gives you an example, actually, of such a framework that we considered in that time, by just dividing the microorganisms we wanted to show in different ecological systems. Like, for example, what do we find on our body? What do we find in space, on the subsurface, in our house, in the water? But as I told you, this really didn't work out consider these this framework as topics for the museum. So what we at one time decided is to just leave this for what it was, and just take a variety of themes, and as a central position is actually myself. So humans. So what do these microorganisms mean for me? And by working out a number of different themes, we were able to create a museum, and each time asking the questions, what is the impact of this microbial life for myself, to my own life? So, as I told you, we finally made it to a museum opened in 2014. Actually by our queen Maxima, and you see her leaving her microbes from her hand on a giant petri dish, and you see she's doing that next to the former head of Micropia, Eveline Hensel. And this was of course a very unique way to open a museum. We had to promise that we were not storing any of the royal microbes in our collection, but apart from that, it was really great that the Queen of the Netherlands wanted to collaborate with this and open the museum. So what do you encounter now if you enter this museum? Well, first of all, we wanted to show the enormous microbial diversity, and show that actually microbial life is in a way much more extensive than all the visible life forms. So we designed this sculpture over here, and the interesting part about the sculpture is that it shows actually all life forms on this planet, but the microbial life forms, they lighten up by these on this fluorescent sculpture. while the visible life forms do not. And by showing this tree, you can immediately see that there is so much more of invisible life on planet Earth than there is visible life forms, like those we encounter in the rest of the zoo, like the elephants and the lions and everything. And we even needed a kind of magnifying glass, which you can see over here, to actually show the part of the animals that were present and on this present in the zoo. Two more things that I would like to tell you about this tree is that, as many microbiologists among you are aware of, is that all life on this planet can be divided in these three domains. So on the left you will see the bacteria branching, and on the bottom you will find all the archaea. So all of the archaea are also invisible life forms. And then on the right you find the eukarya, and part of the eukarya are invisible, so it's the yeast and the fungi, but this also includes all the visible life forms, including the mammals and humans. And then there is this separate part here, the viruses. Well, and those are not really considered life forms because they are not able to grow independently without a host, so that's why we put them there under the tree. So such a museum, of course, it has never been done before, so there are a number of exciting challenges you're facing in the development, and one of them is how do we show these microorganisms to the public. It was very important to us that we wanted to show them real life, because as in the normal zoo you have all these animals, and we want to do exactly the same for the microbes. So we kept a living collection, we developed that, of about over 250 of these microbes, and for each of them we needed to develop the methodology in order to be able to show them for a long period of time under a microscope. And it was not only this was a challenge, but also the microscope itself, because, well, if you have people that are not trained, it's quite challenging actually to look under a microscope. So we developed our own microscopes, in which we made them very robust, so they would not be damaged easily, and also easy to operate by, as you can see here, a joystick that allows you to navigate in this microbial world, so to speak, and an additional bottom that has a zoom function. So by doing this, everybody is able to become a microbiologist and look into the microscope. And this is just an example. And that's also important that we wanted to develop this museum with all kinds of separate exhibits. So in this particular case, you look at the medicine makers you will find in the soil. Very important, because they actually provide antibiotics, one of the major achievements. So almost all of them are actually produced by soil microorganisms. And this is what we wanted to tell in this exhibit. So we had a microscope, the living microorganisms under the microscope. And here on the right, you find what we call a content screen. And this content screen can operate in several modi. So what you can see is the live image on that screen. So also other people will be able to watch. You'll find additional background information about the microbe. And also we gave an assignment to animators to make a short movie about actually what we wanted to show in this exhibit, explaining the major message and the importance of these microorganisms shown in the content to our daily life. So if we now continue our trip through the museum, you see that we took this quite literally. What does the microbes mean for us by including a body scan? And it's, you can see over here with an interactive device which allows you to navigate through all different sites in your body. And by doing so, you can get all kinds of information on, well, well-known term, I assume, to all of you, the human microbiome. So you can have a look at your intestinal microbiome, as well as your skin, the oral microbiome. And what's really cool about this feature is that it actually starts with a scan, and it scans your body and gives you an estimate for the total number of microbes that are inhabiting your body space. So let's continue our trip now through the museum, and over here you see that it's actually a quite dark space. So we designed the museum in a way, it's kind of some kind of inverted laboratory where all the light is coming from the exhibits. So this also gives you the impression of a rather mysterious world in which you become submerged, so to speak. And to add to that effect, we created a specific sound design which allows you to actually get an experience of these microbes. And even though, you know, we know of course that they do not make any sound, but it adds up really to having this submerged experience in the museum. Here on the left is actually one of the greatest symbols of microbia. It's a tardigrade. It's a small animal. You find it everywhere around the world, even in your own back garden. It's a bit smaller than even a 1 millimeter, and it's really known to be a very extreme survivor of all kinds of conditions. And it's not being active under these conditions, but it has this extreme characteristic that it can be completely dehydrated, and in this dehydrated form survive all kinds of conditions, even travel through space. And once it finds a surrounding where it where there is water and where there is food, it kind of inflates again and just starts living again in this new environment. So continuing our trip, we do see here that life of microorganisms has been extremely diverse, and there's actually no niche on this planet in which bacteria are not able to thrive. And that's what we wanted to show in this microbial theater, the extremophile theater. So over there, by turning this giant wheel right here, you're able to move to all kinds of different environments and get information about the microbes that are living in these environments. So like I already said, the thermophiles living in their extreme conditions concerning very high temperatures, so this is in the deep sea. But then we have also, for example, at Chernobyl, the organism Radiococcus Deinococcus radiodurans, which is able to survive very high doses of radiation, and it has a very unique mechanism to repair its DNA. So you see all these kind of fascinating adaptations that are developed over the evolution by microorganisms, allowing them to thrive under all these different conditions. And I think this is also a very important message, because we can make use of these properties for all kinds of different applications. So that brings me to the collection of microbes that we keep. I already told you more than 250 of these microorganisms are actually kept in the museum. And we set up the laboratory in a way that is actually integrated part of the museum. So there's this enormous window in the museum, and you can see the technicians here at work in the laboratory, keeping the collection. And also this is a very important role in education. So we have interns here that are doing their internship over a period of time. So that's an additional role here of the lab. And I would like to give the word now to my colleague Jasper. He's actually right there in the lab, and he's going to tell you some more about this.
Thanks, Remco. Hello everyone, my name is Jasper Buijks. I'm head of Microbia, standing in front of our own Microbia lab. As you can see, this is part of the museum as well, but this is also the heart of the museum. Because like Remco just told you, Microbia is full of live microbes, over 250 different species of them, and they're all cultivated here in our lab. So if we want to show a tardigrade, a water bear, we also have to cultivate some algae to feed it. And that makes it a very unique location, because it's possibly also the most diverse collection that you would find in such a small location. And that makes it also interesting, because we have all kinds of different lab technicians with different expertises, from marine biologists to virologists to bacteriologists, you name it, and we've got them. But the cool thing is, it's not just amongst themselves that they can learn each other something, they can also teach our audience. Because aside from being, well, the home of our microbes, the lab is also part of the museum in our educative program. Because two or three times a day, we have our so-called lab talk, where our lab analysts are set free into the world. They come out into the museum and they talk to our audience. They tell a story about a certain subject, but they also interact with them, because that's often the first time that normal people, so our visitors, can interact with white lab coats and ask them questions, because why are you wearing a white lab coat? What's your favorite microbe? And that makes it a unique place inside this unique museum. So maybe if you're in the neighborhood, come by and say hello to our lab technicians. Bye.
Okay, Jasper, thank you very much for your contribution. So getting back to the museum now, and we continue our trip here along the wall of petri dishes, beautiful forms of art in itself, and it also really gives you this insight that on all kinds of objects in our daily life, microorganisms are present. And I think what is important here to tell you is that our main mission is that those microorganisms are in general not harmful. So we know the microbial world in general very well from, for example, infectious diseases or from microbes that spoil our food. But what we want to convey here is a completely different message, that of course those microorganisms are there, but they are the exceptions. What we do see in our daily lives is that microorganisms, for example, in our body, are a very important and integrated part of human physiology, and they play an essential role in maintenance of our health. So while we have been focusing on these exceptions and giving the microorganisms, so to speak, a quite bad reputation, what we really need is to turn this around and consider them and also their enormous potential in order to improve our health and also the environmental challenges that we are facing on planet Earth. I think also there we have an enormous potential and we have not been using that sufficiently to today. But of course there are pathogens, nobody can deny that, and we want to also give some information about them in the museum. So therefore we also needed to find alternative ways to show them. And for example, we did this by by glass sculptures of the viruses we obviously cannot keep in the museum. So over here you see the HIV virus, and it's kind of difficult to see, but here on the right you have the example of the Ebola virus, also a beautiful glass sculpture. Then we wanted to of course also pay some attention to all these different applications and all the fun projects you can do with microorganisms. For example, here you do see an artist who was able to grow mycelium in all kinds of shapes and in all kinds of different applications. Like for example here you see that he created some kind of vase, but there is even furniture. Really the sky is the limit when it comes to all these different applications you can use with simply growing fungi in the form of mycelium. So we had a special exhibition here in the museum about the work of this this very innovative work of this artist. Another aspect of the museum that we considered a lot is that the information needs to be layered, and what I mean by that is that it needs to be accessible to all kinds of target groups who have all kinds of different levels, so from the last classes of the primary school all the way to the level of students. So therefore we also considered a way to collect your microorganisms in the museum by a stamp. And that's of course a lot of fun, but you can go around the museum and collect your favorite microbes. And then as a next step, you can actually go to a device here. It's actually right in front of me, but you see this the same level here behind me. And this allows you to upload the microorganisms you have collected in the museum. In general, this is of course all about education, so Microbia developed a large number of different education packages for pupils from the primary as well as high school. And by doing so, they are kind of prepared when they enter the museum and learn a lot more by the classes they took before entering the museum. You see them, for example, here at the Petri Dish wall. Not only on the level of high school, but also on the on the academic level for students. We have a number of lectures here, so I'm giving here the annual lecture on the human microbiome and health and disease. And for this, we also have a beautiful lecture hall, which is right here in the center of Artis. And the students are attending the lectures here, and of course combine that with a visit to the museum. Well, in the beginning of my talk, I told you that Micropia is much more than a museum, and it's in fact also a platform. So we developed all kinds of different ways to bring microorganisms under the attention of a much larger audience. So one of the things that is also connected to that lecture series is the annual Microbiome Award. So all the students attending my lectures need to think of a project, an application in which they look for for example, a medical or industrial application using what they have learned about the human microbiome. And each year the student with the best idea wins the Microbiome Award of €1,000. And this is, for example, the first edition of this award in 2016, which was won by Sarah Botschuiver, and she developed this very interesting idea about a pacifier with microbes, which allows you to transfer microbes from mother to child in case of a caesarean section. So it's not only the annual Microbiome Award, but we organized a large number of events, which altogether form the outreach platform of Artis Micropia. And this already started with a research which was connected to the opening about intimate kissing. I told you that the idea of the kiss, so the microbial started with a kiss, so we thought it would be really cool to connect this to some research where we invited actually visitors from Artis on a beautiful summer day to kiss each other, and we monitored the microbial transfer from partners from one to the other, and we determined the complete microbial composition that we found on the tongue and in the saliva before and after the kiss. And this is a so-called analysis where we looked at the at the similarities of all the data that we collected. And we did a very nice finding that we reported in the journal Microbiome, that actually the oral microbiota on the tongue of individuals that have a relationship is much more similar than unrelated individuals. And also we found a correlation with the number of kisses per week. So if couples kiss more frequently, we found that in the saliva the microbiota is more similar. Well, of course, this research raised a lot of attention, and it went actually around the world, starting here with a very nice news feature on the BBC. We did not only use this for research, but we also implemented this result in the museum itself by the Kissometer. So here you are invited in the museum to enter a stage, kiss your partner, and then the kissometer is able to evaluate your kiss, so to speak, and gives you an impression of the amount of microbes you transferred. So I can all invite you to come and have this analysis going on in the museum. So this research was followed up by another research of microbes from the laboratory I was working in. And it's a completely different topic, but another topic where we could really engage the public in the important work that microbes are doing. And that is actually the topic of fermented foods. Because we all know that microorganisms play a very important role in, for example, the production of wine, beer, bread. And we really wanted to raise additional enthusiasm for this topic and showing the good work of microbes. And therefore, we developed in the laboratory a novel starter culture, which allowed you to grow specific bacteria in ingredients like milk. And I'm not sure if you're all aware of this, but this is, for example, an EM picture of yogurt. And you see this is a combination of two bacteria that work together to convert the milk into yogurt. So this is Streptococcus thermophilus and Lactobacillus bulgaricus. And what we did is we in fact constructed a new duo of bacteria that together is also able to make a yogurt. But now in this case, we replace the bulgarius by a probiotic bacterium with additional health benefits. So what is more fun to actually apply this starter culture to all kinds of products and organize a dinner. Actually, you see me standing here just on the same place where I'm standing right now, with all people enjoying their variety of fermented foods made with this starter. And it's not only that we could apply this in a restaurant, but we deliberately developed this starter for actually a program where we taught people to start up their own yogurt business in East Africa. And this worked quite well, this initiative that was started about 10 years ago. You see here in an orphanage in Uganda where the kids are enjoying this yogurt. And actually over the period of this 10 years, we have now about 300 production units, small companies that all make this probiotic yogurt in three East African countries. I just stay a bit with this topic of probiotics, is actually a guide that we developed with researchers and the museum together about probiotics. And we launched this a number of years ago, and the purpose really was to give a much larger audience, the public, an impression of what are actually the health claims related to probiotics. And we did a review in where we looked at efficacy of probiotics after the treatment of antibiotics, because there was a lot of unclear about this. So we published that work in the journal BMC Gastroenterology, and allowing people to really have a look at, okay, these are the products that are available on the market, and this is the evidence that is presented in the scientific literature. Likewise, we organize the debates. So we do these. We use this microbiology platform in all kinds of different ways about the hygiene hypothesis. So we invited a lot of experts from the Netherlands and asked them about their opinion about this hypothesis. And then we used a number of statements and see if these experts agreed or disagreed with these statements. And the two major, let's say, results from this debate I put here is that, in fact, if we consider this hygiene hypothesis, that is that it's actually not really a good term. The biodiversity hypothesis is a much better term, and there is no clear consensus about effective interventions. And just as an introduction to all of you, I guess most of you are familiar with that, but it's actually the point that exposure to microbes, and about this point all the expert agrees, is very important for the development of our immune systems in early life. So in view of the time, I just want to address one final topic, and that's a more recent research that we started here in last summer, and that's really exciting. It's about the gorillas, where we are looking at the activity of the gut microbes in gorillas after a diet intervention. And the whole point is that if we look at these gorillas, you see that their diet, of course, in the wild and in the zoo is quite different. And we wanted to rewild, so to speak, the gut microbiome of the gorilla by giving them additional branches, because that's what they are consuming a lot in nature, leaves and the bark of branches. And those very difficult those components are very difficult to digest. So we figured that we would that this definitely would affect the composition, but also the activity. And what we really like about this is that this is, of course, giving a beautiful connection of what's going on in the zoo and microbia. But even for humans, this is relevant, because this is really about introducing more fibers into our diet. And that's a very actual topic for humans as well, because we also see that going from let's say, a lifestyle of hunter or gatherers to what we are now doing now in the city. Completely different lifestyle, devoid of microbes. It's important to really go back to some of the ancient habits in terms of diet and see if we can improve our health by that. Okay, I would like to thank you very much for your attention. I hope you enjoyed this talk, and I of course hope that I will be able to meet you very soon here in Micropia. Thanks a lot.
Is there life on your nose? Sure there is. Your nose is home to a lot of creatures. Microbes, they live on your body and in the rest of the world. On your phone, for example, but also 5 kilometers underground. There are many, many microbes. If all the people on Earth could fit into a teacup, you would need a container to fit all the microbes in the world. Microbes can do many amazing things. They can create whole entire families in under 1 minute. They can live in boiling water. And they eat all kinds of things like metal. And in some cases, even oil. Microbes. They are the living creatures that digest your food. In case you thought you did this on your own. Without microbes, we wouldn't be here. In fact, we can't live without them. Without microbes, we wouldn't have anything to eat or any oxygen to breathe. So we're happy to have them around. Microbes are fantastic. Meet your microbes in Micropia, Amsterdam.
Okay, so we are back with Jasper. Thank Professor Remco Kort for giving us a great presentation. And we have 5 minutes for questions. And I've already written down 10 questions for you, Jasper, but we can't possibly address them all in this short 5 minutes. So I'll get a head start and ask you the first question, which is, what ages do you see visiting most at Micropia?
Well, we said Micropia should be available to anyone. And what we see now is that really everyone visits Micropia from really early ages to really old people, but also different levels of interest. So people that have no clue of what microbes are, expecting, of course, some kind of horror show because of all those disgusting and dirty bacteria. And of course, well, really getting to know themselves differently when they leave Micropia. To lab teams of microbiologists that are really happy that they finally have a museum of their own.
Great. And we received lots of questions about your collection and how do you, you know, maintain all of this. But I think the most popular one was, how do you collect all the samples that you have in the museum? Do you actually go out and collect them from the Netherlands? Do you receive them from abroad? What happens there?
Well, in terms of our collection, our platform function is also very important. So a lot of what we have, we got donated by research groups, for instance, that have been doing research on the specific strain of bacteria or fungus or whatever for a long time and have donated the strain to Micropia as well. But in other cases, if we want to show more about, the microbe life in a ditch, then of course we go out into a Dutch ditch to find whatever microbes we can find there. So it's a broad collection, but it also has a broad amount of origins. Yeah.
Okay, and I think let's do one last one. So which one is the number one question people ask you guys when they visit Micropia?
Well, I think it's two questions, really. One of them is, are there so many microbes in me as well? And that really shows a lot of people really think of something like microbes, something far away from their day-to-day lives. And then the second question they often ask us is, when they've seen the water bear, so the tardigrade, does the tardigrade live in me as well? Because then, of course, they think, oh, the tardigrade looks pretty cool. Maybe that's one of my microbes. And then I can tell something, well, very interesting at next, holiday or whatever family meeting. So it really focuses on themselves. And that's also what Micropia is about. Like Hemko said, we really want to show people that they are themselves really more microbe than man, which is important because you really have to love your microbes and take care of them to also take care of your own health and your own future.
Yeah, great. Thank you for that. I think we need to wrap up because we have, it's 1 o'clock, so we need to hand on to the next speakers. I just want to say thank you to you, Jasper, and to everyone in the team in Micropia that worked to create this nice video tour for us. And thank you to everyone that has submitted the questions. And if you happen to pass by Amsterdam, make sure you visit the Micropia Museum because it's going to be loads of new bacteria, viruses, fungi join your collection every week, I guess. So even if you have already visited, do make sure to go again because there's always new stuff to see.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jasper.
Enjoy the rest of the day. Thanks so much.
Bye.
Bye-bye.